ॐ नमः 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 कर्णमिवर्तिभ्यः गुरुभ्यः. सो दैट इज मास्टर काल ऑफ एडिशनल सैल्यूटेशन. सो तस्मै ब्रह्मणे नमः टू दैट ब्रह्मन् द वेदात्मन् टू दैट ब्रह्मन्. सो ऑफ द नेचर ऑफ वेद हू इज नन अदर देन द मैनिफेस्टेशन ऑफ लॉर्ड हिमसेल्फ to that Brahman, to that Veda, to that Lord and Form Veda, our salutation. Namaha tat anuvartibhya gurubhya. And our salutations also to all the teachers that have followed, you know, the following teachers. Sadashiva samarambham, Sankaracharya madhyamam, Asmadacharya pariyantam, Vande Guru Paramparam. That is how Bhashyakara salutes the entire Guru Parampara or the succession of the teachers. So this is how, well, we have to look at the Prolopatra before this gets completed. And that begins on the page 1551. Atha idanim samasta prapancha samasta pravachanam shayri bhashyamat भाष्यम अत्राहु वार्तिकाचार्य तथाई अथैदायन समस्त प्रवचन वंशैवी भाष्यम. सो दिस वा अथैदायन समस्त प्रवचन वंश दैट पोर्शन भाष्य अत्राहु वार्तिकाचार्य इनफैक्ट द होल भाष्य ऑफ द होल ब्राह्मण. सो वार्तिकाचार्य एक्सप्लेन्स हियर दे हैव कोटेड ऑल द वार्तिकास एक्सेप्ट द लास्ट फ्यू एंड सो विच आर द नेचर ऑफ प्रेयर एनीवे. And so these vartikas are quoted here, Sambhavitam, and the explanation of this is found from the next page. One, two, three, four, five, six, seventh line from the bottom, on the page 1552, right. So says the Tika here, Vamsha Brahmanatha Kathanatham Vrittam Sankirtayati. Vamsha Brahmana Kathanatham. Now that Vartikara wants to explain or wants to comment upon the Vamsha Brahmana Kathanatham. Vamsha Brahmanatha. So meaning of the Vamsha Brahmana is what the Vartikara wants to state. Vrittam Sankirtayati. Then Vartikara here states, what has gone by, vrittam? Sambhavitam iti. Sambhavitam natat yat purvam krishnesmin brahmane vidat shirakandle tadakhilam putra manthanta meritam. So, yat purvam means yat tat purvam, so purvam kandadve सर्वत्रावि ब्राह्मणे वक्तुं न संभावना उपनीतम् संभावितम् यत् पूर्वम्. सो दैट विच वाज नॉट डिस्कस्ड, सो नॉट कंसीडर और नॉट डिस्कस्ड इन द सो फार नॉट. सो एक्सप्लेन द होल शिलाकांड. सो बिकॉज द पॉइंट टू बी मेड इज दैट दिस वंशा दैट इज गिवन हियर, दिस सक्सेशन ऑफ टीचर्स गिवन हियर is for the whole text and not for the Khilakanda. That's what, as Vashyakara said, Vartikara also says that. And to say that gives a background of to explain why this Vamsha belongs to the whole Upanishad and not just to the Khilakanda. As to why it is Khilakanda. So what's the place of Khilakanda and why therefore it does not require a separate succession. Therefore, this succession is for the whole Upanishad and not just the Khilakanda. That's what Vartikara wants to say. So, Vamsha Brahmanatha Kathanartham Vrittam Sankirtayati. For that purpose, the Vrittam, what has gone by, is being stated here. So, Sambhavitam Niyat Purvam. So, whatever it is that was not considered earlier or not discussed earlier, what is that? So Tika says, yat tat purvam kandadvaye sarvatravi brahmane vaktum nasambhavanopanitam. So in the earlier two kanda, namely Madhukanda and Munikanda, in the total kanda, sarvatravi everywhere there, brahmane vaktum nasambhavanopanitam. So that was not considered in those two brahmanas, or two kandas rather, so Madhukanda and Munikanda. Vaktavyatvena shishtam. So, sambhavitam nayapuram, krusne asmin brahmane vitat. Here, brahmane is in the sense of this Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. So, asmin krusne brahmane, yat puram na sambhavitam. In the entire brahmana, the entire Upanishad, of these two kandas, what was not stated, khilakande tadakhilam, putramanthantamiritam, and vaktavyatvena shishtam. So it was not stated in the earlier two kandas, but then Upanishad thinks that it must be stated. So vaktavyatvena shishtam. So Brahma Vidya, which was taught there, and various upasanas also which were taught there, so Upanishad feels that it does require an appendix. It does require a supplementary section. So vaktavyatvena shishtam, tat sarvam asmin kande. So tat khila kande tad akhilam putra manthanta meritam. So khila kande, in this khila kanda, khila means a remainder. And so in this kanda which gives a remainder, putra manthavasanam uktam. So putra manthantam, up to the putra mantha brahmana, all of that is stated here in khila kanda, which was not considered in the earlier kanda, but which was required to be stated. Otherwise, suppose you don't need it, then why do you have the khilakanda in the first place? But then, there was no occasion to say this kind of things in the earlier discussion. So therefore we say, this will tell you later. You know, a few things you tell later. So because you don't want to get distracted from the main thing that you are speaking right now, you know. So main stream of discussion is there, then you feel the need of saying this. But then you say that, this you will say later. Because right now the discussion will get, there will be distraction if you say that right now. And therefore, and sometimes appendix means you need not even read it sometimes, you know. Or you read it, then you get some further information upon what you have discussed. Anyway, so here of course later can be, later means in succession it comes later also. But here, Upanishad thought that this needed to be stated, but there was no occasion to state it there, and therefore it isn't stated in the Khila Kanda. All the way up to this Putra Mantra. Then the Tika says, Pratyekam Madhumani Kandayoho Vamshabhatva Plap Asseva Ayam Vamshaha Sandhidhana Tathacha Katham Samastra Prapanchavamshani Bhashmityasankyaha. So Pratyekam Madhumani Kandayoho, in each one of them, Madhukanda as well as Munikanda. So, vamsa-bhaktvat, each one of them was possessed of a vamsa. So, kandayoho is actually six case. So, both Munikanda, Madhukanda and Munikanda, each of them, he is possessed of a vamsa or its own succession line of teachers. Tadvat, similarly also, Asteva ayavamsha sannidhana. Therefore the vamsha that is given here should also belong to this khila kanda only. That's, so after the conclusion of each kanda, we find a vamsha. So we found a vamsha of the conclusion of the Madhukanda, we found a vamsha of the conclusion of Munikanda, we find a vamsha of the conclusion of khila kanda, and so following the same trend, it's reasonable that this vamsha of the line of teachers must belong to khila kanda. Tathaja katham samasta pravachanam shari bhashyam. How come Bhashyakara says that this succession is for the entire Upanishad? Iti asankyaha. So, having raised the doubt, Vartikara replies that purvayati. So, purvakanda ekadeshatvat khila kandam na vamshabhat. Purvatra vidyasambhedat bhinno vamsha vihoditav. Purva kandekadeshatvat.
Khilakanda. Since what we call Khilakanda, the remainder, is a part of the Purvakanda, is a part of what was stated earlier. Therefore, Khilakandam the Vamshava, part does not need a separate Vamsha, because part being included in the whole, therefore the Vamsha that belongs to the whole also naturally belongs to the part. Okay. Then the question was, how come each of the two, each of those kanda had a separate vamsha? Purvatravidyasandhyadat vinna vamsha iha uditau. How come the two, each kanda had its own vamsha? Because vidyasandhyadat, so each one of them told a different vidya. Although the explanation was that the Madhukanda told the same Brahma Vidya by way of the Agama Pradhanyat, where Agama revelation was the primary means of communication, and Munikanda communicated the same knowledge by Upapatti Pradhanyam, meaning the reasoning was the main means of communication. So this method of communication being different, even though Brahma Vidya is the same, the method of communication being different, therefore, they think that the two separate vamsas are justified. Purvatra vidya sambhedat. So in the two kandas, since the vidya was different, therefore, bhinna vamsav iha uditav. Ihaiti chaturthantam sasthantam chaha. Iha means, at the conclusion of the second chapter, conclusion of fourth chapter, therefore the two lines of successions were told. Then Anandagiri says further, katham kandadvayasya bhinna vidya avishayatvam. Why should those two kandas have a separate vidya? Nahi brahma vidya ubhayatra bhindade. We find that in each of this Madhu and Munikanda, it is brahma vidya that is actually communicated. So why should you think that there are two different vidyas? So nahi brahma vidya ubhayatra bhindade. It is not that the brahma vidya is different. Vidya of brahman is the same. Vedaka abhavat. Because Brahmana are not two. If Brahma were more than one, then Brahma Vidya also could have been more than one. And so Satyam Brahma is one, Jnanam Brahma is another one, Anandam Brahma is a third one. So this Vidya for Satyam Brahma, other Vidya for Jnanam Brahma. Is Satyam Brahma different from Jnanam Brahma? But Brahman is one. Vedak Abhavat. There is nothing that can actually distinguish one Brahman from the other, because there is no Vedaka. It is Nirvishesha. Nirupadikam. If the Vishesha is there, Upadhi is there, Guna is there, then Brahman can be different, but there is nothing that they can differentiate one Brahman from the other. It is non-dual. The Brahma Vidya also is one, and therefore, why should you say that two different Vidyas were there, and justifying thereby the two Vamshas? Iti Ashankya Madhukanda Artham Darshan Vamshasya Tatra Arthavattam Aha Madhukanda Artham Darshan. So what's the meaning of Madhukanda? Stating that Vamsasya Tatra Arphalattam, that Madhukanda definitely deserves, or Madhukanda should have its own Vamsa, because this is what Madhukanda does. So Purvahiti. Purvais Chaturbhir Adhyayahi Tvastram Kaksham Chayan Madhu Vyakhyaram Tat Asheshena Vamsas Tatra Tadarthabhav. So this Madhukanda apparently Purvahi Chaturvi Adhyaya. Understand that the first two Adhyayas we haven't studied. So actually Purvadhanyaka is called Astadhyayi. But the first two Adhyayas is Pravargakhyam Karma. That first two Adhyayas discuss the karma, pravarga, etc. And therefore Vashyakara chose not to comment upon that. But if you include them, then Purvahi Chaturvi Adhyaya. The first four Adhyayas, then ending with what we call the Madhukanda. So ending with our second chapter. Tvastram kaksham cha yan madhu vyakhyatam. Tvastram madhu, kaksham cha madhu. Tvastram, so belonging to trashta. Kaksham, and that which was hidden, that's the meaning, you know. So this madhu, which has in it, then vyakhyadam has been explained or described in the first four chapters. Tat asheshana vamsha tatra tadarthava. So asheshana vyakhyadam, that tvastram kaksham madhu was explained in its entirety. And therefore, tatra vamsha tadarthava. Therefore, the line of teachers related to that, meaning that then we should understand that the vamsha that we find at the end of the second chapter belongs to the first four chapters. Not only for our two chapters, but the first four chapters. And because in the earlier two chapters also, this was, that is also part of that, and therefore, tatra vamsha tadarthava. It is that meaning that is communicated by the teachers belonging to that succession. Says Tika here, dvitiya tachabdha tasmat arthaha. So purvai chaturvi adhyayi tvastam kaksham tyanmadhu vyakhyam tat asheshana vamsa tatra tat arthabhat. That dvitiya tat artha. Tachabdha tasmat arthabhat. Vamsa tatra tasmat arthabhat. Therefore, that vamsa is meaningful there. Arthabhat चतुर्थांते चतुर्थांते वंशः निर्दिश्यमानः मधुद्वयस्य आगम संप्रदाय प्रतिपादनार्थत्वात् फलवान् इत्यर्थः. सो चतुर्थांशे वंशः निर्दिश्यमानः. सो दैट वंश दैट हैज बीन निर्दिश्यमानः. सो दैट हैज बीन इंडिकेटेड देयर एट द एंड ऑफ द फोर्थ चैप्टर. और चतुर्थ मीन्स दे काउंट द चैप्टर एनीवे फ्रॉम दैट. सो दैट चतुर्थ इज अवर सेकंड. But here, purvai chaturvihi, so all the four chapters, and therefore you would understand that that vamsha applies to all the four chapters. It's slightly different way of, showing the difference. Chaturthamse vamsha nirdishvana madhudvayasya agama sampradaya pratipadanasatvat. So both this madhu, the first two chapters and second two chapters, so both of them actually coming down from Agama. So that was the nature of revelation. Therefore, Arthavat Halavanitya. Therefore, it's meaningful. It serves the purpose there. Then, Sri Ramanagiri, Munikanda Pravritti Pradashana Purvakam Vamshantarasya Arthavatvam Aha. Munikanda Pravritti Pradashana. So what is the Pravritti of Munikanda? What is that Manikanda does? Pradarsana Purvakam. So, showing the pravritti, the activity, or the role, or the contribution of Manikanda. Vamshandrasya Arthavatvamaha and Vartikara Shosav, the Vamsha mentioned at the end of fourth chapter also is relevant, is also meaningful, or it also serves its purpose. Madhuri. So, the Vartika says, Madhukandagamasasya yathavat pratipatte kandam syad yajnivalkiyam vamsasthad vishayastatha. So, Madhukandagamasasya yathavat pratipatte. So, Madhukandagamasasya. So, Madhukanda was the nature of agama. So, the knowledge that was revealed in Madhukanda, yathāvat pratipatte, in order for us to understand. So in order for us to understand what was revealed in Madhukanda, the reasoning was required. So yajñavalkyam kandam syāt. So yajñavalkya or munikanda is in order that we can properly understand what was revealed in the Madhukanda. That way we can say that Madhukanda is of the nature of śravanam and the munikanda is of the nature of mananam. In Shravanam, the Agama is, so Agama Pradhanyam is there. In Mananam, so Upapatti or Tarka Pradhanyam is there. That's the arrangement. In Brahma Sutra also, the first Adhyaya is basically Shravanatmaka. Second Adhyaya is of the Mananatmaka, there are more reasoning. In the first Adhyaya, basically the Shruti Vakyas are more enlightened. in the second adhyaya then, all the reasoning is provided at the same time, the khandana mandana is done, all the guru pakshas are also taken, and then they are refuted. So that way, for removal of the doubts. And so, no doubt one understands what has been actually communicated by revealed text, but then whatever doubts may arise, so requires the clarity, resolving by way of reasoning. So yajnavalkyam kandam syat yathavat pratipatte. For yathavat, for the true understanding. And so understand the well understand or truly understand what is stated in the traditional teaching of the Madhukanda, for that the yajnavalkya kanda is there. And therefore, vamsastad vishas katha says Anandagiri here, yathavat pratipattihi. Nyayadvayana, vipratipatnidasena, avagatihi, kathasari, tadvishayakasya, jnanasya, tarkasampradana, pratipadaka, dvitiyovamso bhavati, arthavanityartha. So, yathavat pratipatti, nyayadvayana. Actually, yathavat pratipatti, and with pratipatti nirasa, that's how we should understand. So, yathavat pratipatti means that you understand the thing as it is stated, as it is told you. And with pratipatti nirasa, also removal of the false understanding. So, what must happen is the true understanding must arise, and whatever false understanding is also must go away. So, yathavat pratipatti and with pratipatti nirasa. Avagatihi. So that's how the avagati of the knowledge takes place. The fasati, tad vishayakasya, jnanasya, tarka sampradayana, sampradaya pratipadaka, dvitiya vamsa. The fasati. So when that is the case, that you must gain the knowledge truly as it is, and also whatever false understanding is there must also be removed. That being the case, tad vishayakasya, jnanasya. So knowledge which forms, so that forms the vishaya, the subject matter of knowledge. So earlier knowledge was revealed knowledge which is to be grasped. Then further the same knowledge is to be understood with reference to reasoning and removal of the false understanding. Taraka sampradaya pratipadaka dvitiya vamsa. So second vamsa is taraka sampradaya pratipadaka. So where the taraka pradhanyam is there, therefore, bhavati arthavan, that vamsa also becomes meaningful. Then, Sri Ramagiri, trutiyopi vamsaha, trutiya kandasyava kimnasyat. All right, fine. So, earlier two kandas had their own vamsa. Then the third vamsa should belong to the third kanda. Trutiyogi vamsa, vamsa trutiya kanda sevakim nasyat. Why should not the third vamsa belong to the third kanda, the khila kanda? It is asankhya. It should not asankhya or asankhya. Purva kanda ekadeshatvaritatra uttam upajivyaha. It was already stated, this question was replied actually. So purva kanda ekadeshatvat khila kandam na vamsavad. So since Khilakanda is a part of the Purvakandas, therefore it does not require a separate vamsa. It was already stated. So Purvakanda ekadeshatvaditya uktam, or stated in a second verse, upajivyaha. And so based on that, Vartikara says why the third kanda does not require a third vamsa. I am waiting. Ayam tu vamsho vignyaya krishna pravachanashraya samapto brahmasya uktehe ayam artho vasiyate. Ayam tu vamsho vignyaya krishna pravachanashraya. Because Vartikara did not say it there, that krishna pravachanashraya, this vamsha on the other hand, pertains to the entire pravachanam, meaning the entire Bhadaranika Upanishad. Why do you say that? Samapto brahmasya uktehe Brahmanasya samapta ukte, because it is stated at the conclusion of the entire Upanishad. Ayam artha vasiyate, therefore we conclude. So we arrive at this meaning. Now we arrived at this conclusion that this vamsha given at the end of the entire Upanishad. So they say that this vamsha is not given at the end of Khilakanda. It is given at the end of the entire Upanishad, you know. So therefore, so tatra gamakamaha samapta vedi. Samapto brahmana se uttehe. This word brahmana is used here in the sense of the entire Upanishad, understand. So, since it is stated at the conclusion of the entire Upanishad, therefore, ayam artha avasiyate. So that is how, so says Anandagiri, Havachana samaptau asya vamshad brahmana se uttehe. Ayam vamsha sarapravajana shesho bhati ityartha. So avasiyate. So this is what we in fact conclude. Pravachana samaptau asya vamsha brahmana se uttehe. Since this vamsha brahmana is stated at the conclusion of the entire, so whether it belongs to the conclusion of the Khilakanda or conclusion of the entire Upanishad, so that's how it is interpreted. Ayavamsha sarapravadana sheshobha. Therefore, this vamsha actually forms a part of the entire Upanishad and not just a part of the Khilakanda. Then says Anandagiri, Purvavada asya phalavattu abhavat. All right, the earlier two vamshas serve the purpose. Because the Vidya Veda was there, and therefore each Vidya required its own vamsha, and therefore vamsha stated in earlier Kanda was meaningful. Puru asya phalavattu abhavat. But then here, so what does this vamsha, what purpose does this vamsha serve? So earlier vamsas serve the purpose, but that way this vamsa does not seem to serve a purpose. And therefore, avaktavyattvam, avaktavyattvam, and therefore, this should not be stated. Iti asinga uktayati. So the next verse is, ukta vedartha vijnana sakalya pratipatte japo vamsa senada sutya vamsa ehodita. These are all the extra things that Vartikara has stated, you know, about this. That is the reason why this Krodhpatra is given here. Bhashyakara has not spent that much time here, but then, ukta vedartha vijnana sakalya pratipatte. So sakalya pratipatte. Pratipatte means knowledge or understanding. Sakalya pratipatte, in order we can understand it in its entirety, you know. And so, in order that one attains that knowledge in its completeness, let us say. Ukta vedartha vijnana sakalya pratipatte. And so ukta vedartha. So what is stated in the earlier kandas, so in order for one to understand its entirety or completeness, japaha vamsasya. It is necessary that vamsasya japaha. One should repeat this line of teachers. So idea is that one should repeat the line of teachers in order that the knowledge that is communicated should be gained or can be gained in its completeness. Ataha sutya vamsaha iha uditaha. And therefore, this vamsa has been stated here by the Shruti. Siddhana iha iti pravachana samaptau sutya vamsa iha udita. Iha means pravachana samaptau. So vamsasya japaha, that's all. So if you repeat the line of teachers after the Madhukanda, you'll get that knowledge. If you repeat the line of teachers after the Munikanda, you'll get that knowledge. If you repeat the line of teachers after the entire Upanishad, you'll get the knowledge of the entire Upanishad. So, sakalya pratipatte. So there each one was a part, here in its completeness. So therefore, for gaining the knowledge, completeness, complete knowledge, or knowledge of complete Upanishad, you must then repeat the vamsa, they remember the line of the teachers for the entire Upanishad. That is why, the japa, basically this vamsa brahman is for japa. We should every day repeat Vamsham Japati, and so one should repeat this line of teachers. Remember them. Because of grace is required, we stated in the second verse. But then, that is why we must do the japa of this last also for gaining knowledge of the entire Upanishad. Then Then says Ramanagiri, itasya vamsatraya sankirtanam kartavyam. Itasya for this, vamsatraya sankirtanam. The three vamsas given, all of them must be repeated. Sarvajnanamiti. So next verse, seventh verse. Sarvajnanamito vamsaha trayopyete yathoditaha atastat smrutitah samyaka jnanabhanundayo bhavet. Sarvajnanamito vamsaha. These vamsas are not ordinary people. Sarvajnana. Each one of these teachers is looked upon as sarvajna, as all-knowing. And therefore, the idea is that etat buddhva buddhiman syat krita krityascha bhārata. Or, what is it? No, not that. The earlier verse of the same Gita chapter, you know. So, sarvavid bhajati mām sarabhāvena bhārata. Lord Krishna said, sahas sarvavid bhajati mām. He becomes sarvavid. He becomes all-knowing. So therefore, the teachers or the knowers of Brahma Vidya are all looked upon as sarvajna. Or sarvajna kalpaha arushayaha. So rishis are also looked upon as like omniscient. As we say, you know, omniscience here means everything is known as Brahman, but then they are as good as sarvajna, all-knowing. So therefore, sarvajnanam yato vamsaha. Since all these three infinite line of teachers is of the teachers who are all-knowing. Trayopi vamsaha. All the three vamsas are of the line of teachers, each one of them is omniscient. And therefore, ete yatha uditaha. So the vamsa, the line of teachers that are stated here, all the three are of the teachers who are omniscient. Atah tasmrutitah samyajnana bhanudeva bhavet. So therefore, tasmrutitah, therefore remembering them. So, samyajnana bhanudeva, the bhanu, the sun will rise. What kind of sun? Samyajnana bhanu. The sun of the nature of the true knowledge will arise by tas, by remembrance of those. So remembering the teachers also is a very important thing. And so, says Anagre, yasya deve parāvatti ityāviśrutehe. Yasya deve parāvatti, yathā deve tathā guru, of course, that's the idea, you know. Yathā deve tathā guru, tasyete kathitā sarthāha prakāśante mahātmanah. Yasya deve parāvatti, the one who has the absolute devotion, parāvatti, the ultimate devotion for the Lord, and one who has a devotion, similar devotion to for the teacher, tasya mahatmanah ete kathitaha yathaha prakasante. For that mahatma. So even his disciple is called mahatma, who has that absolute devotion or a great devotion for the Lord as well as for the teacher. So therefore, ataha tasmutitaha. And so remembering the teachers means then inviting grace for teachers, that's what it means. And so inviting their grace and for gaining the knowledge. Therefore, ataha tasvatitaha. Therefore, by the remembrance of them, samyajnana bhanu udayaha. This rising of the sun of the true knowledge will take place. So, vamsatraya. So, two verses were given here. How this third verse also is phalabhāt, because it is also for gaining the knowledge of the entire Upanishad, you must repeat this. And all the three vamsas were repeated to gain the grace of the teachers. Then says, purva-vamsau purusa-viśeṣitau tṛtīya stri-viśeṣitah tatra-kim kāraṇam iti āśaṅkya. But we find the first two vamsas, where the teachers were named after their fathers. Then, tritiya, stri visheshitaha. In the third line of teachers, each teacher is identified or named after his mother. Tatra kim karana? What's the reason there? iti asanga stri prahanyat, that bhashya. So this first vakya bhashyakara, atha idanim samastha pravachana vamsaha, that took all these verses, you know. So that took 7 verses. Then stri prahanyat, this vakya bhashyakara is now explaining vatrikara here. Because there is a predominance of woman in gaining a worthy son. Worthy or virtuous son, woman has a predominance. That's what this Putramantha Chakarma says. So says the 8th verse, next verse. Putramanthena samskaraha stri-nāme-veha varnitaha yata-yata stri-pradhānayam putrānām vamsaha ucchave. So, in this karma called putra-mantha, so putra-manthena stri-nāme-veha samskāraha varnitaha. So, in that putra-manthākya karma, in that whole procedure that was stated, mainly the stri, the woman that was to be purified, by sprinkling and things like that, you know. And so, a samskara, the purification of the woman was stated that. Yataha, since that was done, therefore, ata stri pradhanayam putranam vamsa uchade. Therefore, this vamsa is stated with the pradhanyam, with the predominance of the woman, meaning predominance of mother. So, Swami Vivekananda used to say, as I said earlier, in the Vedic culture, the woman was always looked upon as mother. In the sense that, so primary position of woman was mother. In the West, the wife enjoyed the primary position. When he went there, you know, this was 100 years ago also, he found all of this. And how perceptive he was, you know, he could perceive things right away. So there here in the United States here, it is wife, you know, that is important. Not so in India. It's the mother who is the supreme, who is the queen of the household. And when the bride comes, she has to serve the mother. She has to wait her own time when she becomes mother. But until then, she has to serve. It's the mother who is dominant role in the household. So India actually worships mother. The West worships wife. There, mother is worshipped. He had justification for everything, you know. I mean, so tremendous amount of love and devotion Swami Vivekananda had for the Vedic culture, for India, for Indian people, for everything Indian. Of course, he had his own tremendous criticism for whatever there was in India also. But as far as the tradition was concerned, he had tremendous love and a tremendous reverence. And he could very forcefully bring out and very beautifully bring out, you know, in every aspect. And so in this aspect also, I don't know how many years he studied this thing, you know, he had a very short time. At the age of 18 he went to Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. At the age of 23 Ramakrishna passed away. He had only 5 years of association with him. And the half the time he did not go there because he was, you know, he would, his mind, you know, he just did not speak to him and stuff like that, you know. And so, so that is how it was happening there. And still, he must have studied Ramakrishna. What did he teach, you know? But then, so he must have studied all these books by himself, and he perceived all of this. So, stri means mother. Stri pradhana means what? The pradhanyam, predominance of mother. So, thus this putra-mantha-akhya karma says that for the virtue or the worthiness of the son, it is mother that has an important contribution, or a primary contribution comes from mother. So, other aspect must come from father, that's all, you know. And so, they say at the end of the text, you know, so whatever is the fault here, whatever are the virtues in what we have written, must all be taken to belong to our teachers. And whatever limitations are there, they all belong to us. Therefore, in the son, whatever virtuous is there must belong to mother. And whatever other thing is there must belong to father, I guess, you know. Anyway. And so, ataha, stri pradhanayam putranam vamsa uchyate. Therefore, ayam vamsa, so putranam vamsa, stri pradhanam. In short, the sons are named after their mother. Yehati anantara brahmanoktihi. So, he means this following brahmana has this vamsha. So, everything is commented upon, you know. Vartikara goes just as Bhashyakara has commented. And so, atas tri visheshani neiva putra visheshanat acharya parampara kirtate, that's what Bhashyakara said. Then, brahma svayambhu iti brahmane svayambhu shabda prayoga nimittamaha. Brahma svayambhu, so brahman is self-born. Iti brahmane svayambhu shabda prayoga. How come the Upanishad says that brahman is self-born? So what's the reason why nimittam? What's the reason why that word svayambhu is used in case of brahman or veda? So anyataha iti. Says Vatikara, anyato anyata evayam sampradaya yathabhavada natatha brahmastasmata svayam bhitti shabdhate anyataha anyateva ayam sampradaya yathabhavada. This tradition follows anyataha anyataha from one to the other. Ayam sampradaya yathabhavada. As this tradition followed from one to the other, natatha brahmanaha. But that did not happen in case of brahmana or veda. Not that brahmana or veda received knowledge from somebody. In this, here, each one received knowledge from somebody. But not so in case of brahman. Tasmātat svayambhu iti sabdhyate. And therefore, that brahman is mentioned as svayambhu or self-born. That's why there is no tita here. Brahma Shabdartham Vyachakshanaha Tasya Acharya Anapekshatvam Sadhayati. Brahma Shabdartham, the word Brahman itself reveals that. So Brahma Shabdartham Vyachakshanaha, explaining the meaning of the word Brahma, Tasya Acharya Anapekshatvam Sadhayati. The very word Brahma in fact indicates that it is no expectancy of an Acharya or a teacher. Anyeshamadhi. So in what way everybody else gets the knowledge? In what way does Brahman or Veda get the knowledge? That method is totally different, and therefore Brahman or Veda has no need for having a teacher. That's what we said here. So that's the Swayambhu self-born. So next verse is Anyesham Vedato Jnanam Bhuri Sadhana Samshayad Svato Vedatmas Tasmat Sarvajnanamayohi Saha. Anyesham Vedato Jnanam. As far as others are concerned, all the knowledge comes from Veda. Bhuri sadhana samshrayat. And doesn't come just like that. Along with the Veda also, Bhuri sadhana samshrayat. So by using many or abundant means of knowledge. So abundant means of acquiring that knowledge. So knowledge that of everybody else comes from the Veda in association with or in conjunction with the implementation of many other means also. So says the Ranagiri, Bhuri Sadhanam Prabhutam Shravanadi. So Shravanam, Shravanadi, Shravanam, Mananam, Nidhyasanam, Prabhutam, much or abundant. Bhuri means Prabhutam. So in abundant measure or in the great measure, one should in fact perform Shravanam, Mananam, etc. and then alone knowledge can come from others. from Veda, Anyasham Vedato Jnanam Bhuri Sadhana Samshayat Svataha Vedatmanah. But Vedatmanah, so Vedatma or Veda Brahma or Lord in the form of the Veda, Svataha, the knowledge comes from itself. Because Veda, it is of the nature of knowledge. So what Brahman is explained here, you know? So, svatah vedātmanah tasmāt sarva-jñāna-mayohi sahab. Because Veda is sarva-jñāna, it is of the nature of knowledge. And therefore, it has its knowledge from itself. That Anagir explains here, paramātmā vedopādi brahma. So what is this Brahman? Paramātmā. So vedopādi paramātmā means vedopādi brahman. So Veda is the upadhi of whom?
that Brahman is, the Paramatma alone is the Veda, or Paramatma alone is called Brahman, Veda Upadhi. So when Paramatma is Upadhi of Veda, that Paramatma comes to be called Brahman. That's the Brahma Shabdartham Vyachakshana. Explaining meaning of the word Brahman here, that who is Brahman? Paramatma. But when does Paramatma get called Brahman? When Veda becomes the Upadhi of Paramatma, then the Paramatma comes to be called Brahman. Svataha Vedatmanah Jnanam na tasya acharya anya acharya tad na acharya peksha. That Paramatma, having that Brahman, who is Paramatma with the Upadhi of Veda, doesn't have apeksha the need of another acharya of a teacher. Sarva Jnanamaya Tvat ityartha. So it says, therefore, Sato Vedatmanas Tasmat Sarva Jnanamaya Vinsah. Because this Paramatma is Sarva Jnanamaya. And that Paramatma alone is Brahman. And therefore, naturally, Brahman does not have expectation or need of another teacher. Why do you say that? Parasya tanmayatve ningamaha sarvajnanamayo hi sah. So Paramatma is sarvajnanamaya lingam. So what's the lingam? So what's the indicatory mark when you say that? The Paramatma is all-knowing. So sarvasya. Next verse is. Sarvasya ishavashityadi tathavi pragavadisham pareva devatavedaha yaccha kinchit characharam sarvasya vashi sarvasya ishanaha. All that came earlier, you know. And so sarvasya ishavashi ityadi. Tathavi pragavadisham. So pragavadisham, this is what we have stated earlier. Tathavi pragavadisham sarvasya esha vashi ityadi. So perhaps when we commented upon this sarvasya vashi, so Brihadaranyaka Bhashyavadika 3829, anyway, this is where it comes, 3829. Or is it so? No, there is no 3829 anyway. That comes in the fourth chapter actually. Vasasitya. Right. Sarvasya vashi, sarvasya ishanah, sarvasya adhipatihi. He is the controller of all, he is the lord of all, he is the ruler of all. Okay, alright. So Arunagiri says here, Ni vashitvadi sarajnanamayatvam vina siddhyati ityartha. So one cannot be the One cannot be the controller and the ruler and the lord of everyone unless one also is omniscient. That's the whole idea here. So, sarvasya esha vashi ityari tathavi pragavadisham. So, sarvasya esha vashi etc. We have said earlier, para eva devata vedaha. So, there we said, therefore, this para eva devata, veda is nothing but the paramatma alone, yet chikinchit characharam. And so whatever exists, movable or immovable, so yet chikin chicharacharam, parayava devata vedaha. So that Lord, who is all this moving and non-moving, that devata alone is his Veda. And it is all omniscient, because it is said to be sarvasya vashi, sarvasya ishanaha, sarvasya adhipatihi, etc. And therefore, that is not possible, as Anandiga says, ni vashitvadi sarajnanamayatvamina siddhyati, naturally. So, of course, to rule over somebody requires knowledge. Ever you cannot rule over them. We find that sometimes you call this person a chief minister, you know, or a prime minister or something like that, or a minister. But then the people do whatever they want to do. The secretaries and assistant secretaries and controllers and commissioners, they do what they want to do. Because they know that this person doesn't know. And what happens is, just anybody is appointed as a minister who has no knowledge of what's going on in his department. So those administrators, bureaucrats, I mean, they know the limitation of this fellow, and therefore they will control him, or they will manipulate him, put it this way. So in order for you to really rule over somebody, it is necessary that you must know your subject matter, know that person also, you know. And you must know everything. You must know that person properly, and you must know what that person knows, or how to take work from him. And therefore, if Lord is the ruler of the entire creation, the Lord of the entire creation, not just for nothing, you must know how the sun functions, how the moon functions, how earth functions, how every atom functions. He knows, then he can control them. So controlling also requires ruling. Just because you get elected by a popular vote doesn't mean that you can become a ruler. You can become a ruler, doesn't mean that you can really justify that position. So says here, nahi vashitvadi sarvajnanamayatvam vina sarvajnanamayatvam vina siddhyaditya. So unless you are all knowing, this vashitvadi, so vashi and then adhipati, etc., a ruler, it is not possible. Tasya sarvanditvam yas sarvajnya sarvetyadi shrutyantarevi prasiddhamiti apehyartha. So tatha ape, and so tasya sarvajnyatvam, then the Lord is omniscient. I mean, you don't need to prove that, but anyway, Vartikara wants to show how Veda does not require another teacher, but doesn't have need for another teacher. Why is it so? Because it is Paramatma, with the upadhi of Veda. So what? Paramatma also may require knowledge from somebody, no? Paramatma is all-knowing. How does he is all-knowing? Because sarvasya vashi, sarvasya ishanaha, sarvasya adhipatihi. This Upanishad perhaps does not use the word sarvajna in case of Paramatma. Therefore, if you resort to this Upanishad, then you must go to that which is linga. Yes, sarvajna, sarvip, it is stated in Mundaka Upanishad, it is very clear. But if this Upanishad does not use the word sarvajna for Paramatma, then what is the other word that the Upanishad uses by which you can arrive at this conclusion that he must be sarvajna? So sarvasya vashi, sarvasya ishanaha, sarvasya adhipatihi. And so all this vashitvam and ishanatvam, adhipatitvam, etc. is not possible unless sarvasya vashi, not just vashi. So whatever it is that you want to rule, you must know that. Therefore, if that snake charmer has to really control the snake, he must know the snake very well. Then alone he can control it. And all in circus also, all those fellows are actually taking work with the animals, you know, wild animals. They must know them very well. So whatever it is that you control or want to control, you must know. Sarvasya vashya. That means he must know everything. Therefore, he must be sarvajna. That's sarvasya is also there. Tasya sarvajnyatvam yas sarvajnya sarvityari shrutyantarevi prasiddhamit apehe artha. So tathavi prag avadisham, whatever. So earlier also it was stated, here also it is stated. Para eva devata vedaha. And so this Paramatma alone is Veda, yat chikinchit characharam. And also it is whatever is chara and achara, movable and immovable. Sri Ramanagiri, parasya vedopadehe brahma shabdatam chet upadhi tadbhavena vedat advaitahani. So we said that, what is Brahman? Vedopadehe brahma is Paramatma. Parasya vedopadehe brahma shabdatam. If Paramatma is upadhi of Veda, becomes called by the word Brahman. So Brahman is Paramatma with upadhi of Veda. Then upadhi tadbhavena. Then we have the Paramatma and the upadhi nature of Veda. Bhedat advaitahani, upadhi upahita. So Paramatma is upahita qualified or conditioned, and Veda is the conditioning. And so then we have these two. Iti asankya parayava. So parayava devata Veda. So Vedopadhi. Don't think that upadhi is different from Paramatma. Parayava devata Veda. that Veda also is nothing but Paramatma himself. Yachikin chit characharam. So, whatever it is, movable, unmovable, that Paramatma alone is Veda, and not that the Upadhi is different from Upahita. Therefore, the duality of Paramatma and Veda is not there. So, Brahman is Paramatma. So, Vangmaya, the manifestation of Brahman, in this form of words, is Veda. That's not that, it is something different. Okay, the remainder will complete tomorrow. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate Om Shanti 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 Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Badarayanam Sutra Hashyakrutau Vande Bhagavantau Punah Punah Ishvaro Guru Ratmedi Murti Bheda Vibhagine Vyomavat Vyapta Dehaya Dakshina Murtaye Namaha Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om Keshavam Badarayanam Sutra Bhashya Krutau Vande Bhagavantau Punah Punah Ishvaro Guru Ratmere Murti Bheda Vibhagine Vyoma Vadhyapta Dehaya Dakshina Murtaye Namaha Om Ushava Ashvasya Medhyasya Shiraha Suryaschakshuho Vata Pranaha Vyatta Magnir Vaishvanaraha Samvatsara Atma Shasya Medhyasya Jauh Prashtam Antariksham Udaram Prasivi Pajasyam Dishav Parshve Avantar Dishav Parshavah Rutvongani Masas Chardha Masas Chaparvani Aho Ratrani Pratishthaha Nakshatranyasthini Nabho Mamsani Uvadhyam Sikataha Sindhavo Budaha Yakrachaklo Manascha Parvataha Oshadayasya Vanaspatayasya Lomani Udyan Purvardhaha Nimlochan Jaghanardhaha Yadvijrumhate Tadvidyotate Yadvidhunute Tastanayate Yannehati Tadvarshate Vageva Syavaga So we are looking at the Vartika here. संभावितं नियत्पूर्वं कृष्णेस्मिन् ब्राह्मणे वितत् फिलकांडे तदखिलं पुत्रमन्थान्तमीडितम्. सो वॉट वॉज नॉट इंक्लूडेड इन अर्लियर कांडास हैज बीन इंक्लूडेड हियर इन वॉट इज कॉल्ड फिलकांड कंक्लूडिंग विथ द पुत्रमंथ. पूर्वकांडैकदेशत्वात् खिलकाण्डम् न वंशभात् पूर्वत्र विद्यासंभेदात् भिन्नौ वंशौ इहोदितौ. सिंस खिलकाण्ड इज ओनली अ पार्ट ऑफ द अर्लियर कांड, देयरफॉर इट डज नॉट हैव अ सेपरेट वंश. द रीजन व्हाई द अर्लियर टू कांडास हैव सेपरेट लीनियेज ऑफ सक्सेशन इज बिकॉज देयर इज अ स्लाइट डिफरेंस इन विद्या, द नॉलेज इम्पार्टेड इन देम. पूर्व ही चतुर्विध अध्याय ही त्वाष्टम कक्षम चयन मधु व्याख्यातम तदशेषेण वंशस्तत्र तथवाद. सो फर्स्ट फोर चैप्टर्स इंक्लूडिंग द अर्लियर चैप्टर्स ऑफ प्रवर्ग्य वेयर द मधु हैज बीन इम्पार्टेड एंड सो देयरफॉर द वंश मेंशन एंड मधु ब्राह्मण ऑल्सो सर्व्स दैट पर्पस टू गिव अस अ लीनेज ऑफ हाउ द नॉलेज केम डाउन. मधुकाण्डागमार्थस्य यथावत् प्रतिपत्ते काण्डम् स्याद् याज्ञवल्क्यम् वंशस्तद् विशेषतसा. एंड मधुकाण्डागमार्थस्य यथावत् प्रतिपत्ते, टू अंडरस्टैंड करेक्टली और प्रॉपरली व्हाट वाज टॉट इन मधुकाण्ड इज याज्ञवल्क्य कांड. देयरफॉर द वंश विच इज गिवन फॉर याज्ञवल्क्य कांड ऑल्सो इज फॉर दैट ट्रेडिशन. सो इवन द नॉलेज इज सेम, the method of imparting knowledge being different, therefore the two vamsas are this serve the purpose. Ayam tu vamsa vijnaya krishna pravachanashraya samapto brahmanasya vakte ayam artho vasiyate. So this vamsa should be understood as belonging to the whole text rather than merely to khilakanda, because brahmanasya samapto it is given at the end of the Upanishad, and therefore we say that this vamsa is meant for the teaching of the entire Upanishad. Ukta Vedartha Vijnana Sakalya Pradipatte Japo Vamsasyenada Shrutya Vamsayhoditaha. Ukta Vedartha Vijnana Sakalya Pradipatte. So this Vamsa is given for the entire Upanishad, because the recitation of this Vamsa then will bring the grace of the teachers, which is meant for gaining knowledge of the entire Upanishad. Sarajnananyato vamsaha trayopyede yathoditaha. And all the three vamsas of course should be recited, because it in fact mentions the line of teachers, each of whom was sarvajna or omniscient. And there were atastas vidrasamneg jnanabhano devavet. And that's the reason why remembering those teachers. So jnanabhano deha, you there, the arising of the Jnana Bhanam, the son of the knowledge, will take place. Putra Manthena Samskara Strinamehe Varnita Yadota Stri Pradhanayam Putranam Vamsuchyate. Inasmuch as the last Brahman in the Khilakanda was, we concluded with Putra Mantha, in which the Samskara was done to the mother, and that the virtue of son, therefore, were due to the virtue of the mother, because she was specially purified, therefore, in this last vamsha, the teachers are mentioned by their mother's name, and named after their mothers. Anyato-nyata evayam sampradaya-vathabhavad dasa brahmas-tasmat tva-svayambhu idi shabdyate. So Brahma or Veda is called Svayambhu, because with reference to all that he self-born, with reference to all the teachers, the knowledge came from somewhere else, but that's not the case with reference to Veda, therefore it's called Svayambhu, self-born. Anyasham Vedadognanam Bhurisadana Samshayat. All the rest gained the knowledge from Veda, with the help of many sadhanas such as Shravanam. Svata Vedatmas Tasmat Sarvajnanamayohisaha. But then, Veda is Sarvajnanamayah. Veda itself is omniscient, and therefore is Svataha Vedātmanaha. As far as Vedātma is concerned, the knowledge is Svataha, by itself. Svayamevātmanātmanam Vetattvam Purushottama. Hey Purushottama, you know yourself by yourself. And therefore, Veda is called Swayam Bhu, because the knowledge, it is of the nature of knowledge, and therefore it doesn't depend upon something else for the knowledge. Sarvasyesha vasityade tathavi pragavadam avadisham pareva devata vedah yatcha kinchit characharam. How do you say that Veda is sarvajnanamaya? How do you say that Veda is omniscient? Because God is omniscient. And therefore, Paramatma Vedopadi Brahma. What is called Brahma here is nothing but the Paramatma with the Upadi of Veda. And Paramatma is all-knowing. Therefore, the Veda being Brahman, being nothing but Paramatma in the form of Veda, therefore also Brahman or Veda Brahma is all-knowing. Sarvasya Eshaha Vashi Ityadi. So Sarvasya Vashi, Sarvasya Ishanaha, Sarvasya Adhipatihi. So when the Upanishad says Paramatma is like that, so this Vashitvam, Vashitvam etc. cannot be unless one also is all-knowing. So Vasha is said yesterday, Nahi Vashitvadi Sarvajnanamayatvam Vina Siddhyati. It is not possible that the controlling or the ruling or the master is not possible unless one knows what it is to be ruled or controlled. Tasya sarvajnyatvam yas sarvajnya sarvityadi shrutyantarevi prasiddhamiti apeheyartha. And that God is omniscient is also stated in the Mundaka Upanishad when it says tasya yas sarvajnya sarvavitaya. Yasyesha mahima bhuvi, and then whose mahima, whose glory is evident in this universe. So, continuing with the verse 12, on the page, the Tika is on the page 1554. So, earlier also, the 11th verse, Parasya Tanmayatve Lingamaha Sarvasyesha Vashityadi Tathavi Pragavadisham Pareva Devataveda Yatcha Kinchit Characharam. So Sarvasyesha Vashi. So in the statement, Sarvasya Vashi, Sarvasya Ishanaha, Sarvasya Adhipatihi. In that, Pragavadisham. So this has been already stated, we have stated that. Para eva devata veda. So para eva devata, it is Paramatma indeed, who is Veda? Yatcha kinchit characharam, and therefore it knows whatever that is, moving or unmoving. In fact, para devata is this whole universe, and that alone is a Veda. So Paramatma is the whole universe, and Veda being Paramatma, therefore Veda knows the whole universe consisting of the moving and the non-moving. So Tika said, Nahi Vashitvadi Sarvajnanamayatvam Vina Siddhyati Ityartha. This Vashitvam, Ishitvam, Adhipatitvam is not possible unless one is all-knowing. Tasya Sarvajnatvam Yas Sarvajnaha Sarvit Ityadi Shrutyantarevi Prasiddham. And that Lord is omniscient is very clearly stated by Mundaka Upanishad, Yas Sarvajnaha Sarvit. That's why that Shruti is very often quoted. Very clearly says, Yas Sarvajnaha Sarvit. Twice it says. So, Yasyesha Mahima Bhuvi, as we say, that comes later. Yas Sarvajnaha Sarvit, Yasya Jnanamayam Tapaha. His tapasya is of the nature of jnana, of the knowledge. And thus, that Upanishad very clearly delineates or states that the Lord is of the nature of knowledge and is omniscient. Then the Tika says, Parasya Vedopadehe Brahma Shabdattvam Chet Upadhi Tad Bhavena Vedat Advaitahani. Parasya Vedopadehe Brahma Shabdattvam Chet. If Paramatma is called Brahman because of the Upadhi of Veda, Paramatma with the Upadhi of Veda is called Brahma, then Upadhi Tad Bhavena Vedat. So therefore, then there is Paramatma and the Upadhi namely Veda. So Veda, there being the difference between the two, Advaita Hani, so that would then assault, or that would compromise the Advaita, the non-duality. Therefore, Vartika said, para eva devata vedaha. It is not that Veda Upadhi is somewhat different, it is Lord alone who manifests as the Veda. And so, para eva devata vedaha. Then, next, Tika says, katham tari pradipadya pradipadagatvam upadhi tatvatvam cha veda brahmanah ishtam. Katham tari pradipadya pradipadagatvam. See, Brahman, Paramatma is pradipadya and Veda is pradipadaka. So Veda is that which expounds, the Paramatma who expounded. So relationship between Vedehi, Sarvehi, Ahameva, Vedyaha. So I am the one that is to be known through all the Vedas. So Veda is the means of knowledge and Lord is the one to be known. So Veda is that which actually teaches or delineates and Paramatma is the one that is expounded there. So therefore expounder, expounded or Upadeshaka, Upadishta. So that kind of Pratipadaka, Pratipadya. So Pratipadya, Pratipadakatvam. The upadhi tadvatvam cha. And Veda is upadhi and Paramatma is one possessed of the upadhi. So you say that Paramatma with upadhi of Veda is called Brahman. So Veda is upadhi and Paramatma is a possessed of the upadhi. So upadhi tadvatvam cha. Veda brahmanoho kathamishtam. Then, if Veda and Brahman, both of them are same, then why do you say that Veda is the upadhi of Brahman? And Veda is Pratipadaka of Brahman. If both are the same, how can there be this kind of a duality between them? Tatraha Pratipadyate. So next verse, 12th verse says, Pratipadyatmanatmanam namarupadi sadhanah edi purnatmaram sakshat dhyam vachamagocharam. Pratipadyatmanatmanam, pratipadya atmanatmanam, swayamevatmanatmanam vetratvam purushottama. He purushottama, you know yourself by yourself. Similarly also, atmana atmanam pratipadya. And so here, in fact, the Veda or the Lord expounds himself. He in fact talks about himself, that's all you have to say. In Bhagavad Gita also, the Lord Krishna only unfolds himself. So who is the one who unfolds? He is the one who unfolds, and he is the one who is unfolded. Similarly also, Veda unfolds the Lord, and that means Lord unfolds himself. So, atmana atmanam pratipadya nam rupadi sadhanaha purnatam purnatmatam eti. And similarly also, a seeker knows himself by himself. So same kind of a problem occurs here also, that if you say that I know Brahman as a self, that I am the knower and Brahman is that which is known, and therefore there seems to be a knower-known duality there also. Same way. So atmana atmanam pratipadya, and so one knows oneself by oneself there also. That means this is the knowledge where the knower-known difference in fact vanishes. And therefore this is also the truth, where the teacher taught difference, you know, also disappears. So pratipadya pratipadaka Veda is not there, even though Veda is pratipadaka and Brahman is pratipadyam. And still, in fact, that difference or duality is not there in the ultimate sense. So that's what Ananda says, kalpita bhedena tat sambhavad, kalpita bhedena. Ishavasyam idam sarvam. This Lord, you know, this universe must be appreciated as Ishvara, the ruler. Why do you call Ishvara the ruler? You call him ruler only with reference to those who are ruled. So when you call Lord the ruler, automatically you are accepting duality of the nature of the ruler and the rule. Says kalpita bhedena. All of these designations are given. Only, so you call him creator. Automatically you are expecting something that is created. You call him controller. You are accepting something that is controlled. Moment we say anything about God, you say that he is the one who always blesses the devotees, then those who are blessed again are different. So accepting the duality which we experience in our day-to-day life, accepting that duality, all these designations are given. This is only kalpita-bheda. So, kalpita-bhedena tat-samhavat. And this is always a big obstacle to everybody. When people ask this question, Swamiji, if I am Brahman, how can I worship myself? Kalpita-bhedena. And so, the Veda, you don't have to imagine the Veda. Veda has already been imagined. As much as Veda of the duality, between myself and Lord is already imagined, therefore the worship has a place. And when that imagination goes away, then the worship has served the purpose. Until then, there is all the ground for worship because there is an experiential duality, because kalpana is taken to be real, and therefore the experienced duality also is taken to be real, and that becomes the ground of my worshipping the Lord. So kalpita-bhedena tat-samhavat na vastva-advaita-hanihi. And therefore vyavaharika-advaita does not in any way assault the paramarthika-advaita. So advaita, the non-duality is there at the level of, so vastavika means in reality, so in absolute sense there is non-duality, and this duality that obtains in vyavahara does not in any way compromise the non-duality which is the reality. This is what the Vedantin is to say all the time, because all the vyavahara is done in a realm of duality. The teachers teach also in the realm of duality. They use the words and all of these limited means also to communicate that which is limitless. And so, all the time these questions arise, how can you ever communicate the limitless? How can you ever know the limitless? You know? And so everywhere, this kalpita-bheda is there. And so, accepting the duality which obtains, accepting the seeming duality that we experience in our day-to-day life, all this vyavahara is meant. Upadeshadayam vadaha jnate dvaitam na vidyate. So Manduka Karika says, Upadeshadayam vadaha. All this vada, this vyavastha is there only for the purpose of upadesha. Jnate dvaitam na vidyate. Jnate bhedam. So dvaitam na vidyate. Dvaita does not remain when the knowledge of the reality takes place. So says, Pratipadya Atmana Atmanam Nam Rupadi Sadhana Punatma Dameti. So Nam Rupadi Sadhana, one possessed the means of name and form. So Atmana Atmanam Pratipadya, this individual who looks upon himself as circumscribed by or limited by nama and the rupa, name and form. So with the sadhana, means of name and form also, he knows himself by himself. Because these scriptures and all of these are the means, and by that he knows himself by himself. How? Sakshat. Sakshat, so pratipadya sakshat punatmanatmadam eti. So he knows himself sakshat, without the aid of any other means of knowledge. He just knows himself by himself. There is aid of no doubt the jnana-vritti. But jnana-vritti is not that which creates the duality of the knower and the known. That kind of a jnana-vritti. Usually when the jnana-vritti is there, ghatakara-vritti is there, patakara-vritti is there, then there is ghatajnata, patajnata, etc. is there. But brahmakara-vritti is there. Is not that the knower of Brahman is different from Brahman. In not that way that the Brahmakara Vritti reveals the nature of myself. So says here Anandagiri, Nishprapanchatvam Sakshad Vivakshitam Sakshad Dhyam Vacham Agocharam. So, nishprapanchatvam sakshadir vivakshitam. So, sakshadir is said. nishprapanchatvam, so that which is beyond the prapancha. So prapancha of the knower known is not there. The prapancha or the projection of the knower known is not there, so sakshat. And further also, ataheva dhyam ityadi visheshanam. So dhyam vacham agocharam atmanam. The self is agocharam, so that self that is beyond the reach of dhyam vacham, of the mind as well as the words. So yato vacho nivartante aprapya manasasaha. And thus, so that which is beyond the reach, direct reach, meaning that the mind cannot objectify, that's all that is meant. What is meant there is that the mind cannot objectify Brahman, or that words cannot describe Brahman. It doesn't mean mind cannot know Brahman, or the words cannot communicate Brahman. That's not what is meant. Manase vedam aptavyam nehananasti kinchana. Ultimately said that there is no duality whatever is to be known through the mind itself. So mind cannot objectify, but the mind can know. The words cannot describe, but the words can communicate. Had that not been possible, of course, all this pravritti would have been of no use at all. And so again there is a big, great misunderstanding with reference to that. And so, ito vacho nivartante aprapya manasasaha. That from where the words return along with the mind. Which is true. And so Bhashyakara has to say that it is the extrovert mind which cannot actually, extrovert mind means the mind that tries to objectify Brahman. That's what we call extrovert mind. And mind that is shuddham antahkaranam. So mind that is purified without raga dvesha, which has become free from this habit of projecting. With that mind, it definitely has to be known. Manase vedam aptavyam. So everywhere, because the experience is of duality, because I am born with taking the duality as real, and all experiences take place in duality, and my culture is totally of duality, and all my samskaras and vasanas, ragadveshas are all duality. That being the case, this non-teaching of non-duality always comes as a challenge. It always seems to contradict everything that I do, including the very communication of non-duality takes place with the means of duality. Accepting that duality is real, the teacher accepts the student as of one who needs, and therefore accepts that seeming duality between the teacher and the student, and then communicates. Or how can communication take place at all? So how can this be there? So upadeshat ayam vadaha. All of this vada, the vyavastha, is merely for upadesha, for communication only. So dhyam vacham agocharam atmanam. So atma, that is, in fact, naturally, atma is the witness of the mind, cannot be objectified by the mind. Atma also illumines the words and cannot be illumined by the words in a direct sense. And therefore, sakshat eti. And though he knows himself immediately. Yet sakshat aparokshat brahma. So that is sakshat aparoksham. Sakshat meaning does not require the aid of the sense organs of the mind. Aparoksham means my very self. Then continuing, vedasya kalpita vedasya atma pradivadakatve pramanantrasyavi tat sambhavat anya yoga vivacheda asiddhihi vyasankyaha. Vedasya kalpita vedasya atma pradivadakatve. If Veda can actually expound or delineate or unfold the Atma or reveal the Atma, if Veda can become the means of knowing the self, kalpita vedasya. So in fact, Veda and Atma, there is a kalpita veda. There is a projected or a seeming duality between Veda and the Atma. So Atma is the one that is expounded by the Veda, and the Veda is that which expounds. So that's the kalpita veda. So Atma pradivadakatve, with accepting the duality between Veda and the Atma, and you say that now Veda can become the valid means of knowledge for delineating the Atma. If so, then pramanantrasyabhi tat sambhavat. Then why not some other pramana, some other means of knowledge also can expound or delineate the self. So, Atma pratipadakatvam is possible. Anya yoga vyavachera asiddhihi. That means that you are not able to exclude everything other than Vedas. So, if Veda can do this, any other pramana also can do that. Because the Veda is kalpita. The Veda is, the duality is something that is imagined. And therefore, why not other means of knowledge also be able to reveal the self? In that case, Veda does not remain the unique means of knowledge. Anya yoga vyavachedaha. So, association with another one is not excluded. So, other option is not excluded here. And that means that other pramanam is possible. Iti asankyah trayiti. The next verse is, verse 13 says, trayeva brahmana vidvan atmani vadvayam param viditva nirvutum yadi kari karanayov param. Trayeva brahmana vidvan atmana eva advayam param. So, viditva nirvutim yati, brahmana nirvutim yati. A brahmana, in fact, he gains nirvuti. Nirvuti means the ananda, or moksha, or bliss as they call it, highest bliss, whatever. So, ananda. A brahmana attains the nirvutishe ananda. A brahmana attains the total fulfillment of life, or total happiness, or freedom. How? So, trai eva vidvan. By knowing trai, trai means three Vedas. So, by knowing the, so trai eva brahmana vidvan, atma eva advayam param viditva. So, param advayam atmana eva viditva. And so, knowing the self that is the param. So, advayam param. So, knowing the self which is non-dual and which is limitless, a brahmana means a seeker. A seeker knows the self which is limitless and that is non-dual with the help of the Vedas. So, atmana eva advayam. So, atmana eva param advayam viditva avidvan. So, knowing the self by the self, this brahmana nirvutim yati. What is the nirvutim? Karya karanayoho param. So that which transcends the aspect, the concept of karya and karana. So that which transcends the concept of cause and effect, that nirvruti. The idea is that moksha, or that ananda that a brahmana or a seeker or a mumukshu experiences or knows, is that which is free from the idea of cause and effect. Meaning that that ananda is not affected by cause. Usually everything is a result of some cause. So similarly, nirvruti or the limitless ananda that this wise person in fact knows, if he knows it as something that is caused by something, if knowledge is caused at ananda or anything is caused at ananda, then anything that is caused also will disappear when the cause goes away. And therefore, so kari karanayo param nirvrutam yati. He attains nirvruti, you call him ayati. He attains, anything that is attained is always going to be limited. And therefore, attainment also is only in a secondary sense. Not that he attains, that he discovers his own self as nirvruti. He discovers his own self as that which is beyond the cause and effect of the nature of the happiness which is limitless. So says here the Tika, nahi pratyakshadina taddhihi. So, see what the Vartikara says, to get the Tatpariya also must require a lot of meditation on the part of the Tikakara, you know, Anandagiri. This Anandagiri Tika on the Vartikara is called Shastra Prakashika, you know. So very beautiful name, Shastra Prakashika. So, Vartikara himself has written things in a very terse way. And sometimes he elaborates very, you know, sometimes he takes a point and elaborates at length. But very often you find that he expresses very profound ideas in a very brief and a terse manner. So one verse follows the other verse, and what's the connection between the two verses also must require a lot of meditation, perception on the part of Anandagiri. And therefore, that this verse says that Veda is only Pramanam, and that the Pramanam does not have the pravritti with reference to Atma, you know, this is how the verse is introduced. So, nahi pratyakshadina taddhi. Anandagiri says that by pratyaksha, by perception, by inference, etc., the means of knowledge available at our disposal, nataddihi, it is not possible to know Brahman, know the Self, because the very knower. So, vijñātāraṁ, are kena vijāniyāt. So, kena. So, kena pramāṇena, by what means of knowledge can you know the knower? And so, nahi pratyakṣādinā taddihi, tad ayogyatvāt, because perception and rest of the means of knowledge available at our disposal, all of them are designed or meant to know something other than the knower. So all the means of knowledge are meant to know something which is other than the knower. Therefore, they don't have the yogyata, they don't have the fitness or the competence to reveal the very knower. Ataha mumukshuhu vedenaiva atmataya uktena svasvarupam viditvayeva nirvanoti. Therefore, mumukshuhu, the seeker of moksha, vedena eva, and so traya eva. So this traya eva means traya eva. It's only by the traya. Traya in the third case is traya. So vedena eva, only by the veda. That's how the Tikakara explains, vedena eva. So traya eva. Brahmaha means mumukshuhu. Atmataya uktena. So, atma eva advayam param, atmataya eva uktena. So, in fact, also Veda also reveals itself. That also you can say. So, the seeker knows himself. And the Veda also reveals itself, because Veda is paramatma. And so, Veda, subject matter of Veda, it's its own self. And so, Veda reveals itself as the very self of the student, you know. So, mumukshuhu vedenaiva atmataya uktena svasvarupam viditva eva. And therefore, so atmana advayam vidvan, svasvarupam vidvan, knowing one's own nature. Nirvanoti nirvatim yati. So, nirvanoti. Here it is nirvati. Nirvati is nirvanam. Nirvanam means extinction of all the anarth. So, nirvana means like a lamp blowing out. Similarly, also a lamp of ahankara blowing out. And that is how ahankara means nothing but the manifestation of dukkha, so all the dukkha blowing out and revealing again the nirdeshayananda, which is one's own nature. So, viditva eva nirvanoti. Tameva viditva atimruttimeti. Nanyah pantaha vidyate ayanaya. This is the Shvetashvatara Upanishad. Tameva viditva. Tameva vidvan. Similarly also, Purushutta also says, and then the Taittiriya Upanishad, but this is most quoted. Tameva viditva, knowing the self alone. Tam viditva eva, knowing, only knowing the self. Knowing the self alone, and only knowing the self, atimrutyam atyedi eva. He definitely crosses the death. So, again the evakara is applied with each one of them. So that Shruti says that. So, no.